everybody. So glad to see each of you here at the Granite Bay Hilltop Church. And you've been such a faithful group coming night after night. It's hard to believe we've had 23 meetings. Also, yes. Want to welcome those who are watching on television right now or on the internet. We've got tens of thousands of people around the country, around the world, that are studying the Word of God with us. And we're just so thankful for that opportunity and just praying that people's hearts are touched and many will make decisions to get them ready for Jesus' return.
Amen.
But we're going to do our best to answer some of your questions. And it's always kind of an eclectic group of questions, but we take a little smattering from everywhere.
And we do our best. Did you notice we're getting closer and closer
in
each
matching?
Night? No, each night.
Oh,
the
okay.
First night we started like this far away, because I don't know why, but now we are
social
married.
Social distancing. And
so,
okay.
That's right. We don't have to social distance.
We're married.
That's right. Just in case y'all were worried.
Okay.
All right, we're going to start with question number one. What is the difference between a true and a false prophet?
Okay, this is sort of a quick review summary of our study last night. We demonstrated from the Word of God there are both true and false prophets in the last days. Jesus made it pretty clear there'll probably be a lot more false prophets than true ones, but God is going to pour out His Spirit. Your sons and daughters will prophesy, they'll dream dreams. So God is still going to speak. How do you know the difference between a true and a false prophet? Very quickly, some of the things on the list would be what they says always corresponds with the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
If they're making prophecies that don't come true, that would automatically make them suspect. If they're doing it for personal gain, if their lives do not have the fruits of the Spirit mm-hmm. in their personal life, their prophecies, you know, they need to be relevant to the teachings of Jesus. And so you can eliminate most false prophets almost immediately just by applying those few tests.
All right. What about the wise men who followed a star to witness the birth of Jesus? Were they astrologers?
No, not really. When you're studying actual heavenly bodies, that was more of astronomy. The wise men, sometimes called the Magi, they were probably from Mesopotamia. How did they know that star was going to be a sign of this coming king of the Jews? There was a prophet named Balaam. He was a prophet of God. Mm-hmm. And he made a prophecy that said a star will rise out of Jacob. His prophecy was recorded in Mesopotamia. He was not a Jewish prophet. Of course, we have it because of Moses recording it. And so they were reading that and they saw this unexplained, brilliant heavenly body. It wasn't a comet. It seemed to direct them over to for them, it was west, mm-hmm. and they followed that star. I think the Holy Spirit also impressed them. But like I said, astronomy is the legitimate study of the stars, and that would have been an astronomical phenomenon they were following, not to be confused with astrology. They weren't saying, oh, this is a sign of Aquarius or Taurus or Pisces or one of those things.
Right. They didn't even have those then, did they?
No. And you know what that star was? It wasn't a comet. It evidently was a band of angels.
Uh-huh.
Because after they left Herod, the star actually came and rested right over the home for a star to direct you to a particular house. And you can't follow the moon to a house. For it to direct you to a particular house, it must have been a mobile body. And we know that there were angels that were singing to the shepherds in the field. And so we believe that they guided, this is a band of angels that guided the wise men.
Because
there.
It took them more than a couple of days to follow this star.
Yeah, they spent months following it.
That's right. How many prophets are there in the Bible?
Yeah, you know, I included that question because I thought it intrigued me, and I just did a little random research, and evidently there are, right away, you know, if you talk about the 70 elders that were filled with the Spirit and they prophesied, you start with 70. But so we're talking about more unique prophets and prophetess in the Bible, somewhere between 68 and 70.
Wow.
And, you know, sometimes some of them, and that, you know, you include people like Moses is a prophet, Aaron, Miriam, David is a prophet, and Samuel was a prophet. So there's a lot of them among the judges that also prophesied.
Wow, that's a lot.
Yeah, quite a few. Quite a few in the New Testament, too. 12 apostles were prophets. Sorry.
Are you done? Should I go to the next question?
Let's try and see what happens.
Okay. Where did the fallen angels and Satan go during the flood?
They went underwater. No, I think that they were on the earth. And I expect that the devil feared for his own existence during that time when he saw the the calamity. See, he had kind of claimed this world as his kingdom, and it was a paradise when he took it from Adam. And he saw the upheaval that was caused by the flood. And why was the flood? The Bible says the thoughts of men's heart were only evil continually. God says, it grieved me that I have made man upon the earth. Just think about that. Broke God's heart that this paradise had been so corrupted by evil. And he said, I'm going to wipe them all out. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord because Noah walked with God. And so the devil, in the destruction of the world, in the flood, he read his own ultimate destruction. And I believe the devil and his angels were very frightened during that time.
So after Job, during the time of Job, Satan went up to heaven and he had a council and he powwowed. So was it after that that he was bound to this earth? Is that why he was on this earth during the flood? Or could he have been in the atmosphere or at a different planet or anything like that?
Now, some of this is speculation, but when you read in Job about this heavenly meeting where God is meeting with the sons of God and Satan comes, and it doesn't tell us where the meeting is. People assume if it's with God, it must be in heaven, but God walked on earth with Adam and Eve. He could have had some celestial meeting somewhere. You read in Revelation 12, Satan was cast out of heaven. That was before our world was made. So we don't think that the devil went back to heaven, but wherever this meeting was, Satan came. Ostensibly, he says, I'm representing this world. And these other sons of God maybe represented other unfallen galaxies or worlds. And the devil said, I've come from the earth. So the meeting's not on earth, but it may not have been in God's dwelling place, paradise, heaven. Is God? God is not in prison in one spot. He's able to roam through his creation. God walked in the garden with Adam and Eve. You remember?
Right.
Came looking for him and said, where are you?
Okay. Will we be judged by the Ten Commandments?
Yes. The Bible tells us in the book of James, so do and so speak as those that will be judged by the law of liberty. And that law of liberty, it tells us, he goes on in James, he says, you know, the one who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not kill. Those are two of the Ten Commandments. You read in Psalm 40, verse 8, it says, so I will keep his commandments forever and ever, and I will walk at liberty because I seek his precepts. So the Ten Commandments are a law of liberty. They're not a law of bondage. When you obey those rules, read what it says there in the beginning of Proverbs. The Lord says that if you obey the law of God, it adds length and health to your days. And so they are a blessing and they keep us free.
Amen.
But yes, it ultimately is the judge. Because we're judged according to our works. That's what the Bible says. We're saved by grace, but your works show whether or not you are saved.
Right.
Jesus comes, Revelation tells us, he'll reward everyone according to his works. The books are opened. The Bible tells us, and everyone is rewarded according to their works. But if we've sinned, we've broken God's law. Sin is the transgression of the law. Jesus' blood will wash our sins away and our record is clean because he pays the penalty.
Right.
So when God opens that book, our name is in the book of life. But we need to also be sanctified, living new lives as well.
Okay. Please explain Revelation 17, 8 to 11.
Okay. I marked this. This is when we talked about the Babylon, the mother of harlots, in Revelation chapter 17. And I didn't read the whole chapter because it just wasn't time to cover it all. But she sits on a beast with seven heads. First, the angel tells us those seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. But now you get down and you read in verse 8. It says, the beast that you saw was and is not and will ascend out of the bottomless pit. Ultimately, the devil is behind this power and go into perdition. And those who dwell on the earth will marvel, whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they see the beast that was and is not and yet is. Now here is the mind that has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. Listen carefully. These are also seven kings. They're seven mountains, and he says they're seven kings. Five are fallen. One is. The other is not yet come. And when he comes, he'll continue a short time. The beast that was and is not, he himself is also the eighth, but he's also of the seven and is going into perdition. Now, I get more email and questions on this passage. I'll tell you what I believe it's saying. These seven kings on which the woman sits, they're seven mountains, and it says the mountains also represent seven kingdoms. When the time that Revelation was written, through history, there have been like seven persecuting powers of God's people. You've got Egypt, from the time Israel was formed as a nation. First persecuting power was Egypt. Then you've got Assyria, you've got Babylon, you've got Greece, you've got Medo-Persia. That's five. Now what came after Greece? Rome. Who was in power when John had his vision? Pagan Rome. Then pagan Rome fell, and it was sort of replaced with what we call papal Rome, a religious power, later known as the Holy Roman Empire, but that was actually a different phase of it. But it receives a deadly wound. But he comes back again. That's why he says he is also the eighth, because he was of the seven. Wounded, comes back against you. Let me say them for you again. These are the seven powers, the way I understand it. You've got Egypt, Assyria, Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece. Five are fallen. One is pagan Rome. He dies, then you get the seventh, that when the church became a political power, you got papal Rome, and that, of course, spread from Europe and around the world. And it says he's also the eighth, so it ends up being sort of a global power in the end. And we've talked about how apostate Protestantism, Catholicism are going to unite, and there's going to be a confederacy of religion in the last days that is going to be a persecuting power. Hope that made sense.
Okay. Can you confirm whether Moses is actually in heaven and came down to see Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, or whether it was a vision? It doesn't say anywhere in the Bible that Moses was resurrected after God buried him.
Well, I think it comes very close to saying
that. I want an eyewitness confirmation, please.
Moses?
I was just kidding. It was a
joke. Well, we actually have biblical witnesses in the mouth of two or three witnesses. Let everything be established. Doesn't the Bible tell us that Jesus brought Peter, James, and John up the mountain with him? He brought three witnesses with him so that they could testify. And Christ told them, do not tell the other apostles what you saw till I've risen from the dead. That's in Mark chapter 9. And it's one thing if someone has a vision. They're wondering, was it real or was it a vision? But when you say to the person next to you, did you just see what I saw? Mm-hmm. And there's three of you, and you say, we all just saw Moses and Elijah. How do we know it was Moses and Elijah? Jesus spoke to him. It says they spoke together of his suffering he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. And it does tell us in the book of Jude, verse 9, there's only one chapter in Jude. Jude verse 9, it says that when Michael came, that he would not enter into contention with the devil over the body of Moses. Now, why is Michael coming for the body of Moses? He's going to raise him. Mm-hmm. And how do you know that? Because Moses appears after that. And so then Michael says to the devil, the Lord brings against you. The devil went to bring railing accusation against him, and Michael simply said, the Lord rebuke you. Then you do have Jewish tradition that says 3 days after Moses died, the Lord resurrected him. It's in a book. It's an apocryphal book, but it's called The Assumption of Moses. We have no reason to believe that is not accurate because Moses was in heaven.
All right. Now, what is the special resurrection?
Okay, good question. Typically, when people die, you're not raised again until the second coming. But there are some people, like the wicked, normally do not raise until after the 1,000 years, right? The rest of the dead do not live till the 1,000 years are finished. But there will be some exceptions. During the trial of Christ, the high priest Caiaphas, he said, I adjure thee by the living God, tell us if thou art the Christ. And Jesus said, hereafter, he said, thou hast said, hereafter you will see the Son of Man coming on the right hand of power. He said, you will see it. And so we believe Caiaphas and those who are involved in condemning and crucifying Jesus, they're going to be especially raised to witness that Jesus was the king. Then they'll die again. They're going to be raised again for judgment. But they're going to see him coming as King of Kings with the rest of the world. And so, you know, the Bible tells us it's appointed man wants to die. Well, that's the vast majority, and then after that, the judgment. Are there some people who have never died? What are their names?
Enoch and Elijah.
Elijah. Will there be some people in the last generation who never die?
Yes.
We who are alive and remain, Paul says, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. I'd like to be in that group. I don't know about you.
Amen.
That we're alive and remain when the Lord comes, we're transformed. So, generally speaking, it's appointed unto man wants to die, but there's some unique exceptions, and Elijah's an exception, Enoch's an exception. Caiaphas, the special resurrection, there are some unique exceptions. That would be the special resurrection.
Why is the second angel's message not cried in a loud voice like the first and third angel's messages in Revelation 14?
Well, I'm glad I kept my finger there in Revelation 17. Let's go to Revelation 18. So you find the three angels' messages in Revelation 14, And it tells us that the first angel says with a loud voice, and the third angel says with a loud voice. Second angel says his message about Babylon. But now you go to Revelation 18. Notice what it says in verse 1. After these things, I saw another angel coming down from heaven with great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his glory. And he cried mightily with a loud voice. Loud voice. That means megaphono, megaphone. Babylon the Great is fallen, and become the dwelling place of demons and the prison of every spirit and the cage for every unclean and hateful bird. For all the nations have drunk the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. That's the interchange between the religion and the state, the woman and the governments. And the merchants of the earth have become rich through the abundance of her luxury. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins and lest you receive of her plagues, for her sins have reached to heaven. So God is calling his people out of Babylon, a special loud voice just before probation closes. We think that that message is going to the world right now. And as Christ said, behold, this prophecy is being fulfilled in your hearing today. Amen. We are giving the three angels' messages, and including the second angel's message. And I'll tell you, friends, compared to what they had to work with in Bible times, when I can speak and it's amplified in this room and it's amplified through television, it's amplified through radio, and it's amplified through the network and the internet all over the world, that's a loud voice.
Amen.
That's not just me. I'm one of many that are doing it. You understand what I'm saying? And so the message is going with a loud voice right now.
Okay. How is it unforgivable to sin against the Holy Spirit when it is God who forgives sin?
Yeah, some people wonder, well, if God is God the Spirit, then why would God say you can speak against me and you could speak against Jesus, but if you speak against the Holy Spirit, wouldn't that be the same as speaking against God?
Right.
Well, if you're just talking about, you know, slandering their name, but the unpardonable sin is resisting the work of the Holy Spirit. It is the work of the Holy Spirit that convicts you of sin, that brings you to the point of humbling yourself and surrendering your life to God. And when people continue to resist the mechanism through which God brings us to repentance, that is unforgivable because it's a sin for which we will not repent. So the work of the Holy Spirit is the only medium through which we can respond and our hearts are softened. We say, yes, Lord, I choose to humble myself, to give my life to you, and to trust you with my life and my salvation. And when you do that, then he can transform you. But if you continue to fight against the work of the Holy Spirit, what more can God do? That's the only way that we will soften our hearts and receive Christ.
So the unpardonable sin is because we choose not to accept the gift of salvation.
God will forgive every sin that you genuinely repent of. The reason that he cannot forgive blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, it's because it's the sin you will not repent of. You will not turn to God and turn from your sins. So you turn off the volume. That's the Holy Spirit, how he speaks to us.
Yes. All right. When Joshua prayed for more time to do battle and God stopped the sun, doesn't that mean that the earth is fixed and the sun, moon, and stars are in a moving circuit? And wouldn't that affect the day for worship?
Yeah, this is one of the miracles in the Bible that has caused a lot of speculation. Joshua, when they were fighting that battle of Ai, and they were gaining the victory. And you know, one of the key things in battle is you want to completely stop your enemy so you don't have to fight them again another day. And the battle was not over, they were winning. And he realized we need more time to tie this off so they don't regroup and come back against us again. And he, inspired by the Holy Spirit, said, sun, stand still over the mountains, moon over the valley of Ajalon. And all of a sudden time in the heavens seemed to stop. And I don't know how they know, but they say for about the space of a day. And it tells you in the Bible there was no time like this before or after. Of course, days of Hezekiah, the sun went back 10 degrees, but that's different. That's like 15 minutes. But everyone said, the earth is rotating at, 20,000 miles an hour. If all of a sudden it should stop, we'd go zinging off. Or, you know, how did God do that? Did all of a sudden the sun start to move and follow and track with the rotation of the earth? And there's all kinds of interesting ideas. You know, one idea I heard, why is it that the Bible says in Genesis that God said, let there be light, and there was light, and he separates the day from the night, but he hasn't made the sun until the fourth day?
Right.
How can that be? Well, the Bible tells us God is light and in him is no darkness. The Bible tells us in the New Jerusalem there's no need of the sun. There will be a sun, but there's no need of the sun in the city, for the Lord God is in there, and he illuminates the city. You read in Malachi, the Son of Righteousness will arise with healing in his wings. God compares his glory to brighter than the glory of the sun. When Jesus was glorified with Moses and Elijah on the mountain, it says his garments were brighter than the sun at noonday. So one way is the glory of God could have stood in the heavens above that battle while the earth continued to turn, and he gave them the light that they needed for a whole day. That, I think, is the most plausible explanation. It doesn't require God reorganizing the cosmos around the planet Earth. I think God was the light during that time.
All right.
I can't prove it, but you can't prove me wrong.
Do you want one more question,
or
is this the end?
No, we can go ahead.
Okay,
one more.
Our last question. I want to dedicate myself to God, and I'm trying to stop smoking. Can I still dedicate my soul, or do I have to stop smoking first?
Oh, please, give your heart to God. You come just like you are. Can you imagine a parent telling their kids, will you all come in from playing now and get cleaned up so you can take a bath? Get cleaned up so you can take a bath? Isn't that backwards? Don't you take a bath to get cleaned up? So you don't try to stop your sins and then come to Jesus. You come to Jesus, and then once he is in your heart and your life, then the Lord and you together will see a great transformation. When I came to the Lord, I mean, I probably smoked for another year and a half after I came to the Lord. You don't have to wait that long. I was just real slow. But I know God was working in my life. Surrender your life to him.
Amen.
And, you know, smoking, you'll find out, will not be the only battle you'll fight. You know, after God saved me from the drinking and the smoking and the drugs and the cursing, and then he said, now, Doug, let's look on the inside at some of the pride and the laziness and other things. And he's continually, you know, when you're working with the Lord, it's like you're walking closer and closer to Jesus, and he is light. And the closer you come to the light, the more painfully distinct every spot of defilement in your character becomes.
Right.
And so don't be discouraged if as you continue walking towards Jesus, you keep finding new things wrong. He's showing you because he loves you and he's purifying you. That's good. That's good news. Well, friends, we want to welcome you again to the Panorama of Prophecy program. We're so thankful that you're here, and we're just having a great time studying the Word of God. We've come to learn that prophecy in the Bible is more than just the books of Zechariah and Daniel and Revelation or Ezekiel. Prophecy encompasses the message of the prophets. And the message of the prophets can be found all through the Bible, a number of books. Our study tonight is dealing with the subject of the king's ambassador. And I really could say the king's ambassadors, because he's calling all of us to be ambassadors for him. We're thinking more particularly of someone who was called by Jesus the greatest of the prophets. You know who that is? John the Baptist. He said, among those born among women, there is no prophet like John the Baptist. And the Bible tells us that he was born like Jesus under unique circumstances, where Elizabeth, late in life, became pregnant. And the angel told the father, Zechariah, he said, you're going to have a son, and he's going to go in the spirit and the power of Elijah. He's going to have one of the greatest jobs in preparing the world to receive the Messiah. He would introduce the Messiah. And the Bible tells us that he had a special dedication. There was a holiness about him. There was a power about him. He was filled with the Holy Spirit from his mother's womb. Even while John the Baptist was within Elizabeth, Mary came to visit her cousin when she was pregnant now. And it tells us that Elizabeth says, the babe leaped in her womb at the tidings of Mary. And so even the Holy Spirit was in him even before he was born. You know, if you look in Matthew, you can read here in Matthew chapter 3, it tells us about John the Baptist. I'm going to read the first few verses for you. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Now, often when kings traveled in Bible times, they had a team that would go before them. Very powerful, wealthy king would have a big team. And when the king was traveling, they would inspect the road, not only for spies and booby traps, but they would prepare the road. They would take the rocks out of the road. If there were low spots and potholes, they'd fill them in. If there were high spots, they'd cut them down, and they'd smooth the path. And the Bible tells us in Isaiah that this was the work of this messenger. He was going to cut down the high places and fill in the low places. And someone said, you know, that's sort of the work of a pastor, is that he is supposed to comfort those who are humbling themselves, that are unhappy, that are struggling, and he's supposed to take those that are too comfortable and make them uncomfortable. And so John the Baptist went out and he would prepare the way of the Lord. Now John himself tells us that he lived a very holy, austere life. John himself was clothed in camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey, and we're all hoping that was carob pod. And then Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region around Jordan, they went out to him. Here's this man that some would probably ascribe to being a maniac out there in the wilderness by the Jordan River. He's preaching that the Lord is coming, that they needed to repent of their sins, they needed to turn back to God. And the people were so moved by the Holy Spirit that not one or two came out, but it seems like everybody came out to hear this man preaching with eloquence and power. He didn't talk like a madman. He had great courage and great force to his speech. And they were baptizing him in Jordan, confessing their sins. And he was bold. When he saw many of the Pharisees and the Sadducees coming to him, to his baptism, he said to them, "Brood of vipers." That's not how you get promoted. "Brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance." Now, what did he mean by that? He said, if you're really repenting, bear fruits. Show that you're repenting in your life. "Bear fruits worthy of repentance. And do not think to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones." By the way, Jesus did that when he called the Gentiles into the kingdom, people that the Jews thought had been forsaken. God called them in to receive salvation. "And now," says, "the axe is laid at the root of the tree. Therefore, every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down." Doesn't matter if you're a priest, a scribe, a Pharisee, poor or rich. He wants us to have the fruits of the Spirit. "Indeed, I baptize you with water unto repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but he'll burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire." And so there was this great revival that was caused by the preaching of John, and he was giving specific information about how to repent and how to live holy lives to everybody. Even the soldiers came to him, and they said, "What shall we do?" And he said, "Do violence to no man." Now, what he meant by that, he didn't say you couldn't be a soldier. He meant sometimes they would rough people up and take their property. But he was telling everybody what they needed to do to follow God. Now, I'm going to have you jump with me to Revelation. This is a message that goes to the world just before Jesus comes. We talked about the 144,000. This is a group that has the seal of God. And we know they're preparing others who receive that seal. And you can read here, let's see. "Then I looked and behold, a lamb standing," Revelation chapter 14, verse 1, "on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 having his father's name written on their foreheads. And I heard a voice like the voice of many waters and the voice of a loud thunder. And I heard the sound of harpists playing their harps. And they sang as it was a new song before the throne and before the four living creatures and the elders. And no one could learn that song except the 144,000 who were redeemed from the earth." Now listen how it describes them. "These are the ones who were not defiled with women, for they are virgins." What does that mean? I've heard some people preach that and say that in the last days, all people saved need to practice virginity. Now, you read in Revelation, that's telling us that you get two women. One of them is a mother of harlots. The other one is pure. And it's saying they are not defiled with women. Talk about Babylon and her daughters. They're not defiled with the false teachings, for they are pure. That's what it's dealing with there. It says they follow the Lamb wherever he goes. How many of you want to follow the Lamb in heaven? Do you know if you want to follow him there then, you need to follow him here and now first? They follow the Lamb wherever he goes. "These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruits to God and the Lamb." They're not the only ones. but it's a special group in the last days. And in their mouth was found no guile, no deceit, for they are without fault before the throne of God. So I think you're getting the message that John the Baptist, who came in the spirit and power of Elijah, the 144,000, and people that are preparing for Christ's first coming or second coming, he's calling them to lives of dedication and holiness. Now, I'm going to make a little disclaimer for you here, you who are watching. You probably will not enjoy this program if you are not converted. If you have not dedicated yourself to the Lord, this is not going to make any sense to you. You're going to be thinking it's legalism. But I'm going to show you from the scripture that God calls people by grace. We are saved through faith. But when you are saved by faith, then you will bring forth fruits that are meet for repentance. Your life should be different if you are a follower of Jesus. What is a Christian? A follower of Christ. And you're going to see Jesus in them. When the apostles were brought to trial for their faith, the judges of the Sanhedrin talked to each other and they said, we can tell these men have been with Jesus because they're talking and acting like Jesus. They could tell they had been with him. And the Lord wants us to represent him in this world. Before we go to the lesson and find out what these different scriptures are and these issues, I thought it'd be good for us to, again, get out on the street and find out what do people think about the difference between Christians and other people.
What are ways that I can spot a Christian in a crowd? I don't know, they're happy.
There's Christians all around us, and there's not a specific look that a Christian has or doesn't have.
People have such odd standards. You can go to church on Sunday and sin on Monday, so I don't believe that you can look at someone and say, oh, you're a Christian.
I think you have to talk to the person and know the person.
If you just lined up a whole bunch of people and said, pick out the Christian, I don't know if you'd be able to. I wouldn't be able to.
I don't think it really matters that much. I think you should be able to present yourself however you want, dress how you want, whatever.
I don't get it. As long as you respect the 10 rules that he gave you.
So no, I don't think there's a particular way that anyone, should dress, but, specific to Christians, I still say the same thing, no.
I think that they should be free to dress however they like, in moderation. Like, you shouldn't be walking around in super skimpy clothing or whatever, but, as long as you're dressed fairly modestly, I think it's all right.
If I were to go around walking around telling people I'm Christian, I should also look that way.
If you want to be fully immersed in that faith, I believe, yeah, you have to follow all the tenets. It's like, no shoes, no shirt, no service. It's like, if you want to be a part of our club, follow our club rules. So if you choose to, become a Hasidic Jew and you got to wear the hat and then you chose it. So do it. Otherwise, you're not a Hasidic Jew, and stop saying that you are.
You're an ambassador of his kingdom, so look like one.
I like that last answer. If you're going to be ambassador for the king, then you should look like an ambassador for the king. We're living in a day and an age where it's really hard to tell Christians from apart from everyone else in the world. And I believe that people should know there's a difference in the way that we conduct ourselves. I was in a restaurant with a friend, and the young lady that was serving our table, as she walked away, I said to my friend, she's a Christian. I said, how do you know? I don't know. Just her smile. There's something about her appearance. There's a simplicity. There's a peace. She came back to the table. I said, now, don't want to embarrass you, but are you a Christian? And she blushed a little bit. And she said, well, yes, I am. I go to church. And she was clearly, from her answer, a practicing Christian. And I don't know about you, but I've been able to spot that before. I think that you can sometimes see a difference. People have this inner joy. They've got this confidence. They've got this peace. And it's almost like, once you are a Christian, you've got this Holy Spirit radar where you can spot each other. But it shouldn't just be with Christians. I think the world ought to see that there's a difference. We're going to find out what the Bible says. Was there something different about John the Baptist? Clearly there was. What was one secret to John the Baptist's spirit-filled life? If you look in Luke chapter 3, verse 16, John answered and said, I baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. And of course, here he's talking about Jesus. One secret of his life was, you notice that he's self-defacing. There is a humility there in his life. One of the keys for a Christian is there's going to be humility. I think it was a C.S. Lewis that wrote in his book, Mere Christianity, a chapter called The Great Sin. And he talks about the devil. The great sin of Lucifer was putting himself in the position of God. And pride is the mother of all sins. Pride is a handle that fits every other sin. And John the Baptist had humility. Even though he was brave and he was bold and audacious for God, he also said in John 3, verse 30, he said, he, speaking of Jesus, he must increase, but I must decrease. As John introduced Jesus and he said, this is the Lamb of God, people began to follow Jesus, and soon Jesus had more disciples than John, and John's disciples began to resent that. You know, there's a spirit of competition. Hey, you know, he's getting more disciples than you, and what's with that? You know, you're the great prophet. And John said, well, this is the way it's supposed to be. He must increase, but I must decrease. You know, that's something that all of us should really be saying in our hearts every day. When it comes to who is on the throne in your life, he must increase, but I must decrease. Would you like to say that with me? He must increase, but I must decrease. And every day that you walk with Jesus, you're going to find out that it's more and more about him. And that's where your joy comes from. Christ said, he that seeks to save his life will lose it. But he is willing to lose his life for my sake, he will find it. We take up our cross, we lose our lives. That's when we really find our lives, when we give it all to him. Number two, did John the Baptist read the scriptures? This is another example in the life of John that I think that every believer should emulate. Did he? How do we know? When they said, John, who are you? This is John, Gospel of John 1:23. He said, I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said. Does it become clear that John read what the prophet Isaiah said? So just because he's living out there in the wilderness in the desert doesn't mean he did not read the scriptures. In fact, if you go visit Israel, you'll find that there was a whole group of very dedicated Jews called Essenes that lived in the Dead Sea area, and their whole job was writing out and copying the scriptures. Later, when the Romans were coming to invade, they hid a lot of them in caves. They were discovered then as the Dead Sea Scrolls. So there was a whole community of people that were dedicated to the scriptures living just down the river from John the Baptist. He knew his Bible. He read his Bible. He prayed. There are three disciplines in the Christian life that are the keys to your success. Now, what I'm about to say is so simple, but it is so true. You do these things and you will not backslide. Read your Bible every day, and even if you read your Bible just 15 minutes, read your Bible 15 minutes, pray for 15 minutes, and it might be 7 minutes in the morning and 7 minutes at night, and spend 15 minutes talking to someone else about God. Read the Bible, talk to the Lord, share your faith. How does a baby grow? They breathe, that's prayer, they eat, they exercise. When I was a baby Christian and I was living up in the mountains, there was a dedicated Christian Jewish convert. His name, we all called him Brother Harold. I don't even remember his last name. And he was an older man. He's probably in his 60s or 70s, but he just knew the Lord like, I mean, his face would shine. I saw his face light up when he prayed one time. His voice would tremble when he read the Bible. And he ministered to all of the Jesus freaks and the hippie young people that were in the community back then. Some of you remember that era. And I knew him. He knew me. He knew I lived up in the cave. And one day I was downtown. I was walking down the street. He used to ride a little three-wheel bicycle around Palm Springs. He used to get day-old bread out of the dumpster. And he'd go visit everybody in the hospital. He would quote scripture from memory. Back then, they'd let anybody, if you wanted to go into a hospital room and you just minister to someone, he said, I'm a chaplain. He'd go in, he'd pray for him, he'd minister, he'd go visit the prisons, woke up at like 3 a.m, read his Bible in Hebrew, Greek, and English. Dedicated Christian man. He was riding his bike down the street, he saw me walking, and he pulled up ahead of me and stopped and said, Doug, how are you doing? And I said, oh, I'm all right. He said, how are you and Jesus doing? I said, oh, all right. You know, I didn't want to go into it, but having some struggles. And he said, Doug, how long can you hold your breath? I thought, that's an odd question. But I was glad he asked because it gave me a chance to brag. And I used to do free diving. I said, I can hold my breath for 4 minutes and 10 seconds. And I expected him to be impressed, but he said, you shouldn't go any longer than that without praying. He said, that's right, you're supposed to pray without ceasing, like you breathe, without ceasing. And he said, how often do you eat? I said, 2 or 3 times a day. He said, that's how often you ought to read and meditate on the Word of God. He said, what's going to happen to you if you don't get any exercise? I said, you get weak and flabby. He said, that's what's going to happen to your faith if you don't share it. So you've got a physical body with real needs, and if you don't take care of those needs, you will suffer real consequences. You've got a very real spiritual body, a spiritual life. And if you don't care for that spiritual life, it starts to dry up and die. You've got to read your Bible. You need to pray. Set aside time. If you can't read very well, get Bible tapes. You can drive down the road and listen to inspirational Christian material and sermons and strengthen your faith. Share your faith. You do these things, you will grow. Do babies ever worry about growing? No. If they're eating and they're exercising and they're breathing, they're going to grow, right? Number 3, was John the Baptist willing to witness for Jesus? When he saw Jesus come to the water, he boldly said, next day, John 1:29, behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. He pointed people to Christ. If you believe in Christ, do not be ashamed of your faith. Be bold in your faith. John was so bold and he was so courageous that he would not only rebuke the Pharisees for their sins, he talked to the Roman soldiers, he told King Herod that you shouldn't be living with your brother's wife. I mean, he called sin out wherever he saw it, and he was not very popular. It ultimately cost him his life. Now, the reason we're talking about this message of the king's ambassadors, the Bible tells us, last prophecy in the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 4, behold, well, first he says, remember, this is Malachi 4:4, remember the law of Moses, my servant, which I gave unto him for all Israel with its statutes and judgments. Behold, I send you Elijah the prophet before the great and terrible day of the Lord. Now, the great and terrible day of the Lord was not Jesus' first coming. That's the day of the Lord when he comes the second time. I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and terrible day of the Lord, and he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Now, this is not just talking about there being family reconciliation. The fathers is talking about the teachings of the fathers. A lot of the young generation have rejected the teachings of the fathers. But before Christ comes back, there's going to be people turning back to the sensible teachings of the fathers. And the fathers will begin to make sense to the children. And there's going to be a revival as a result of that. So how did Elijah come? Well, when they came to John the Baptist and they said, are you Elijah who is to come? John the Baptist said, no. Why did John say, no, I'm not Elijah? And Jesus said, yes, he is. When the Jews were asking John, are you Elijah? They were wondering, are you Elijah reincarnated? God does not teach reincarnation. He said, no. They were asking a different question. You see what I'm saying? Jesus said, is he coming in the spirit and power of Elijah? Yes, he did come in the spirit and power of Elijah. That's what the angel told his father, that he would come in the spirit and the power of Elijah, just like Elisha got the spirit and the power of Elijah. But Jesus said, if you can bear it, Elijah has come. This is after John was put in prison and beheaded, and they did unto him whatever they wanted, and Elijah will come. Christ was looking down to the end of time when there's going to be a great revival movement and people are going to return to the Word of God the way that John the Baptist brought a revival movement. There are going to be some last day Elijahs before Jesus comes back that are going to be sharing this message of holiness and living godly lives. Number 4, was the straight preaching of John popular among the political and religious leaders? No. The Bible tells us the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the will of God for themselves, not having been baptized by him. It kind of makes you shudder to think, you know, here God was calling them to repent of their sins. They could keep their jobs, but they needed to repent and be washed, and baptism was part of that. When they rejected that, they were rejecting the counsel and the will of God for themselves. And there's some of you who are listening to the sound of my voice. You could be here. You could be listening through some electronic media right now. And maybe he's calling you. If you've not given your heart to Jesus to repent of your sins, to be baptized and to follow him, listen, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. You want to follow that and repent of your sins. He'll give you a revival. And then you read on in Luke chapter 3, verse 19, but Herod the Tetrarch, being rebuked by him, by John the Baptist, for all of his evils that Herod had done, he shut up John in prison later because of the intrigue of his illicit wife, Herodias. John the Baptist was beheaded. And Jesus said, here, he's the greatest of the prophets, but he did not go to heaven in a fiery chariot. You know, Jesus said, if you're persecuted for Christ's sake, you should rejoice. John actually had the privilege of dying for the sake of Christ and for the sake of the truth, and he's going to be greatly exalted in the kingdom. Do you believe that? All right, let me tell you a little amazing fact. In the early 1800s, there was a physician by the name of Joseph Lister. Matter of fact, a lot of medicine is sort of dated before and after Lister. At the time that Lister was studying medicine, deaths in hospitals were just staggering. The doctors often said, well, the operation was a success, but the patient died. And the reasons were they practiced no sanitation. I know it's hard to believe, but they would go from one patient to another. Doctors would go from dissecting a cadaver, and then they'd go deliver a baby and never wash their hands. They would go from one patient to another patient. All they wore was bloody aprons. There was nothing to cover their mouths to protect their breath and infection. There's no washing of instruments. They'd keep using the same instruments day after day. And so many people came for simple procedures, and then they died in the hospital through infection and blood poisoning. Lister looked at the Bible. He was a dedicated Christian man. And he saw the laws that God had in the Bible, in Leviticus, where it talked about if you touch someone who's sick or dead, you should wash. If anything's exposed to something that was dead or sick, it should be washed or burnt. And he listened to the teachings of Louis Pasteur. And he said, you know, we need to make some reforms. And he had a clinic that he opened up in Glasgow in Scotland. And he told the nurses, he says, we're going to wash all the instruments. We're going to wash and wear clean clothes. And we're going to sterilize things before each. And they protested, and everybody thought he was crazy. They thought he was eccentric. They gave him such a hard time for years. He was the laughingstock of the medical community. But then as the months went by, they noticed he's got a pretty high survival rate in his hospital. I wonder why. And little by little, they stopped laughing at him. And then other doctors and hospitals started noting they couldn't fight the facts that, 90% of the women that came there survived, where up to 50% of the women that came to deliver in a hospital died. There was a better chance of having your child at home than a hospital back in those days. And they began to incorporate some of his teachings pretty soon. Louis Pasteur said he was one of the greatest men in history. He ultimately was knighted for what he contributed to medicine. They say that if his discoveries had been made 10 years later or 10 years earlier, one third of the people who died in the Civil War would have survived. Because so many of the surgeons in the Civil War, they just were amputating using the same equipment and the same, and so many died from infection and disease. If they just learned these simple procedures of cleanliness, they didn't know how important it was. By the way, he developed an antiseptic that's called Listerine that is still on the shelves today. Well, we're going to talk about holy living in our presentation today. And again, sometimes people struggle with these things. Now, not only did we discover John the Baptist prayed, he read his Bible, he witnessed, and we're going to find that he had a simple diet. He also dressed modestly with simple clothing. So we're going to explore some of these different avenues, or should Christians be different in some of these practical areas? And we're going to give you scripture. Sound fair enough? Are you with me? If it's in the Bible, do you believe it? Paul said, am I your enemy if I tell you the truth? You want the truth, right? All right. What does the Bible say? Let's talk a little bit now about just Christian appearance. You know, the first thing that happens when you meet someone, you see on the outside. Does the Bible discourage the wearing of jewelry in fancy or flamboyant clothing? Let's see what the scriptures say. 1 Timothy 2, verse 9, in like manner also that the women, and of course men, adorn themselves in modest apparel, not with braided hair or gold. There's no sin against braiding, The word braiding means they had a custom in Rome and Greece where they would embroider gold chains and jewels in their hair. And that was the word that was used for that whole process. Not with broidered hair or gold or pearls or costly array. So do not let it be this. Doesn't mean Christians need to wear burlap, but Christians, our clothing should be simple, clean, and modest. God wants us to be known as people who are, we're not extravagant. There's a lot of people that need to hear the gospel. A lot of people are dying for want of the gospel, and he doesn't want us to spend everything we've got on trying to make a big impression. Read also 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 3. Do not let your adornment be merely the outward arranging of the hair, the wearing of gold, and putting on of fine apparel. Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart, which is an incorruptible beauty of a gentle and a quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. So what's the important thing with God? Is it the jewels and the adornment on the outside or the adornment on the inside? In the ancient Temple of Solomon, was there gold? Lots of gold. Where was the gold, outside or inside? It's on the inside. It's pure white marble. Your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. And yet in the world today, people spend a lot of time with outward adornment. And by the way, you know what I'm sharing with you right now? You might be thinking, I've never heard this before. This is actually a teaching of the fathers. This is an old teaching. If you were not only Protestants, but even Catholics, they taught that believers should be modest in their appearance. And again, modest doesn't mean that you've got to look dirty. I think a Christian, you ought to buy clothing that's going to hold up. That's usually more economical in the long run. And clean, presentable. You don't want to look so out of style. Who was it, John Wesley, that said, in the styles that you wear, you should not be the first one to adopt a new style, neither should you be the last. So what would be the principle for a Christian's clothing? Well, you want it to be high enough and low enough to cover business. You realize that when Adam and Eve sinned, that after they sinned, their garments of light went out and they saw each other's nakedness and they were ashamed. I don't know why they were ashamed. They were married and there's only people living in the world with him. Of course, the angels were watching. And they were so mortified, they went running off in the woods and they started to try to cover up certain spots with fig leaves. They made aprons. The word that is used is they made mini skirts. That's the Hebrew word of leaf. And God finally talked to him and said, what you've done is sin. It says, God gave them tunics of skin. Not only did they have the wrong material, they did not have nearly enough material. Now, why are we wearing clothes right now? Well, on some occasions, you wear them for protection from the environment. But I'd probably be just fine if I took off my clothes right now. I don't think I'd freeze to death. So is there another reason that we're wearing clothing? I think everyone knows naturally, there's sort of a natural understanding. It doesn't matter where you go in the world. Even in the most primitive cultures, they tried to cover some things. They might use a gourd, but they try to cover things. And the reason is because people naturally understand that there should be some modesty. And in case you ladies did not know this, men can be distracted sexually through their eyes. If that was not true, pornography would not sell. Women can too, but men especially so. That's why Jesus said, if a man looks on a woman to lust after her, he commits adultery with her in his heart. It's visual. So if it's a sin for a man to look at a woman's figure and be thinking things that are inappropriate, of course it works vice versa, would it be a sin for a woman to deliberately dress in a way that would accentuate those things that would distract men? And I've seen women compliment each other for, ooh, that's sexy. And you're going, are you wanting to go out on the street looking sexy? And exactly why are you wanting to do that? Are you wanting people to notice that? I think we're going to be shocked in the day of judgment. We think, you know, got a man out there with a dirty mind, and maybe there's a woman out there that's causing 50 men a day to stumble because of the choices she's making. Am I telling the truth? Yeah. I'm not going to ask how many of the men will say amen, but this is what Jesus was talking about. There should be a modesty in our appearance. And again, we don't need to be flamboyant with the jewelry business. The Bible doesn't have a lot to say out of that. In that day, you read in Isaiah chapter 3, speaking about the daughters of Israel are puffed up and they're haughty. said they walk around mincing and swishing as they go. And in that day, he talks about the judgment that will come upon them. They'll take away the finery of their jingling anklets, the pendants and the bracelets, the veils and the headdresses, the leg ornaments and the headbands, the perfume boxes, the charms and the rings and the nose jewels. When the children of Israel made a golden calf, where'd they get the raw materials? The Bible says that Aaron told them to get the earrings from your sons and your daughters. It wasn't just the girls. And they fashioned their jewelry into a golden calf. And then after that time, God told them, break off your ornaments so I can know what to do with you. The Bible doesn't have a lot good to say about this. I think Christians, I don't know if you notice, you know, I don't wear jewelry. I'm not trying to compare myself, but I just don't want, some people are concerned about their appearance. Maybe they're concerned about their self-worth. And so they just, you know, they maybe try and increase their perceived self-worth by putting beautiful jewels on. Of course, this stuff can be very expensive. It could be cheap too. But I believe the Bible tells us that we ought to refrain from wearing these kind of ornaments. Not only that, you can read where it says in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 28, you shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead or tattoo any marks on you, for I am the Lord. Now, I don't know if you realize, but your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Is it just my imagination? Or does it seem like in recent years there's more tattoos that are happening in more tattoo parlors? Is that right? Is it just my imagination? Or are people doing more body piercings now than they've ever done before? Am I just imagining that? Well, you know, in the Bible, it doesn't have a lot good to say about that. It says that the pagans had the custom of cutting themselves and disfiguring their bodies and mutilating their bodies. And it doesn't matter if you're putting a bone through your nose or a bone through your ear. And, you know, this people are piercing all different parts of their body right now. But you read about the prophets of Baal. And they leapt on the altar and they cut themselves until the blood gushed out. You read about the demon-possessed man in Acts chapter 5 who would cut himself with stones. And the whole idea of mutilating your body or adding extra holes, you know, when the Lord made you, he made you with the appropriate number of holes. And God did things just right. And your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. And all the crazy things I ever did long before I was a believer, I was never tempted to get a tattoo, and I was never tempted to pierce myself. Because, you know, as you get older, everything always gets worse. Why would you want to accelerate that? And you're already going to get all wrinkled, and you get age spots and stuff, and if you get your age spots all over your map that you tattooed on your back or something, it really looks bad. And I don't know how many friends I know that they tattooed some girlfriend's name somewhere and then they changed girlfriends and they had to get the tattoo artist to try to weave the new girlfriend's name into the old letters. And it looked all blotchy and strange. And I know now, some of you right now, you're saying, Pastor Doug, you know, there's a lot of people going to be offended by what you're saying. The Lord says, you shall not make any cuttings in your flesh for the dead or tattoo any marks on you. And it's not like, you know, it was one or two piercings and one or two earrings. Now it's all the way up the ear. It's not just the earlobe. It's through the ear. It's through the nose. It's through the lip. It's through the tongue. And I'm sorry, friends, but when I'm ordering a Subway sandwich and the girl there is making my sandwich and she can't talk to me because she got this big stud in her tongue, that's kind of strange. I don't think that was ever God's plan. I was at the store the other day and I saw a girl, she had just rings all around her ear. And again, I'm just telling you that this is not what God tells us if you're trying to advertise for Jesus. You say, what would Jesus do? And I thought that must hurt to put that many holes. And I kind of was wondering, is she picking up radio frequencies when you do all of that? I don't believe that's what the Lord's plan is. Follow me. Children of Israel got involved in worshiping pagan gods. And the Lord said to Jacob, you need to put away the strange gods that are among you and come meet with me at Bethel. And it says they buried their idols in their jewels. The Bible's pretty clear. It says, let it not be the outward adorning. So Methodist, Baptist, Pentecostal, Christian, they all used to teach simplicity and modesty in Christian appearance because you're representing Jesus. Whenever you're in doubt, say, what would Jesus do? This is what the Bible teaches. Now, the devil believes in body piercing. You know how I know? What did he do to Jesus? All right, question six. We still friends? You notice I saved this to the last few meetings. Was there a connection between John's spirit-filled life and his simple diet? You can read in Luke chapter 1, verse 15. For he, John the Baptist, shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, but he will be filled with the Holy Spirit. You see, there's a distinction between being filled with wine and being filled with the Holy Spirit. You've probably driven down the street and you've seen these stores. It says liquor, beer, and spirits. What do they mean, spirits? What kind of spirits? If you drink the liquor and the beer and the wine, you get spirits that come with it. Have you noticed that before? Yeah. And, you know, I'm speaking from firsthand experience, friends. I used to drink. I know what happens. It says you'll say things that you regret. Your eyes will behold strange women. I don't know how many people have said, you know, I was at a party and I had one too many. I'm so sorry. I violated our marriage. I wasn't thinking. It wasn't me. It was the alcohol. Well, you chose to drink the alcohol. And people do and utter and behave in ways that, it just takes you away from being spirit-led. John the Baptist would not drink wine or strong drink. Why? Because he wanted to be filled with the Holy Spirit. So which spirit do you want to be filled with? Do you want to be filled with the spirit of vodka and whiskey and gin? Wine and beer? Or do you want to be filled with the spirit of Jesus? This is one of the reasons he was consecrated to God from a child. When the angel came and talked to the parents of John the Baptist, what did he say? Oh, I didn't read the question yet. Why is God concerned about what we eat and what we drink? Judges chapter 13, verse 7. So the angel meets with Manoah and his wife, and he gives clear instructions on this child they're going to have that's going to be filled with the Spirit of God. Why would it matter what a mother, before the child is born, eats and drinks? Well, you know, now they know that the mother's care for her body, why she's pregnant, does have an impact on the child. Behold, you shall conceive and bear a son. Now drink no wine, or similar in the word there, strong drink, or eat anything unclean. For the child shall be a Nazarite to God from his womb to the day of his death. Through his whole life, he was to be dedicated to God. Now, as we near the last days, if we're wanting our minds to be clear, especially when Satan has come down with great wrath and the world is just filled with his proliferation of deceptions, why would we want our brains to be fuzzy so that we can't distinguish between what's right and wrong? Why would we want to weaken our perception so that we are not able to discern what is good and what is evil? The real prayer of Solomon, when God said, "What do you want from me?" He said, "I want wisdom that I might have an understanding heart to know the difference between good and evil." And I think that that distinction has been lost in many Christian churches about what is right and what is wrong, what is holy and what is not. A Christian is a follower of Christ. You need to say, "What would Jesus do?" And you know what? When you're in doubt, do the safe thing. I know. Let me just make it real clear. There are going to be people in heaven that drank alcohol. There are going to be people in heaven that smoked. There are going to be people in heaven that wore jewelry and maybe did not dress right. You all listening to me? People live up to the light they have, and God is merciful. But for me, knowing what the Bible says, I don't want to see how close to the line I can get. I want to stay as far away from that line, that precipice, as I can be. I remember a few years ago, a lot of evangelists got into trouble for their flamboyant lifestyle, and they had gilded sets on television. They're begging for everybody's money, and they found out they had air conditioning for their dogs. And I mean, it was just the extravagance of how they were living was just really sad. And some critics out there in the world, people love pointing to Christians that are hypocrites. They say, "You don't look like you're following Jesus. What's with all the gold and the jewels?" And their wives were always, you know, decked out, made up, and done up, and bejeweled. And they said, "So this is what it's like to follow Jesus?" Somebody wrote a song, "Would Jesus Wear a Rolex?" So, mocking Christians. And so, I just want to, if I'm ever in doubt, listen. When you're ever in doubt, do the safe thing. I am not going to stand before the Lord in the judgment day, and God's going to say, Doug, sorry, you didn't make it. I'll say, why, Lord? Doug, you did not wear enough jewelry. Is he going to say that to me? No. So if there's anything that's questionable, or you didn't drink enough alcohol, if there's anything like that, I want to just stay as far away from it as I can be. And I'll tell you another reason is love. Love for you, love for God. Let me illustrate. I pastored a church of Navajo Indians in New Mexico, and I think I mentioned this to you, and wonderful people, and they struggled with alcohol was a real problem. And I could drink one glass of wine a week and probably not become an alcoholic, but if they could point to me and say, he's drinking a little bit, then it might be the means of them stumbling. And so to avoid even making them stumble, I don't want to make anyone stumble. I know a man who was an alcoholic for years, and he got off alcohol. He was living clean and sober. He went to a pastor's house. Actually, he was an elder of the church in this Presbyterian church. And he came home. They invited him home for dinner. And there at dinner, they served a nice meal, and they began to pour wine. And he began to look very nervous, and they said, what's going on? He said, well, I've got to just tell you right now, I'm struggling right now because I'm a recovering alcoholic. I've been sober now for 3 months, and I just wasn't expecting to see that here. Now, how do you think that would make them feel? They're just about to make this, destroy this brother. Why would you want to put a stumbling block in front of somebody else? Do you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, who you have of God? All right, moving right along. What does the Bible say about worldly behavior? Now we've talked a little about eating and drinking and dressing, that there should be a distinction. James 4:4, whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Now, Pastor Doug, I thought the Bible said God so loved the world. Here it says you're supposed to love the world, and then the Bible says friendship with the world is enmity with God. Which is it, love the world or hate the world? Well, God loves the people in the world, and we should love the people in the world, but worldliness is what he's saying that we should shun. And I think we all know what that means. Just all the distractions with the here and now. If you're a Christian, you're thinking about eternity. You're thinking about another world. You're passing through this world. Someone once said that a Christian is something like a ship in the water. A Christian has to learn how to be in the world without the world being in us. A ship belongs in the water. But as soon as the water gets in the ship, you've got serious problems, right? Come out from among them, the Bible says. 2 Corinthians 6:17. Be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean. This is the New Testament. It's not some Old Testament Levitical law. He says, do not touch what is unclean, and I will receive you. Come out, be separate. We're to be different from the world. We're calling people to a high and a holy standard of following Jesus. How can we tell them to do that when we're living like everybody else and nobody can tell the difference? If anyone loves the world, the Bible says, 1 John chapter 2, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but the world. And the world is passing away with the lust thereof, but he that does the will of God will abide forever. Can you say amen? If you love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Do not be conformed to this world, but rather be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Don't become like the world. Don't let the world shape you. Be shaped by the Word, not the world. The Word ought to be shaping our lives. And the renewing of your mind. Now, with that in mind, what should a Christian choose to think about? Whatever things, and this is Philippians 2, verse 4, chapter 4, verse 8. Whatever things are true, these are the things to think about. Whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report. If there's any virtue and if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Think about those things that are good. Bible tells us in Psalm 101, verse 3, I will set nothing wicked before my eyes. Now, based on that standard, what should a Christian watch? If we believe murder is a sin, why would we be entertained watching other people murder? If we believe adultery is a sin, why would we be entertained watching other people commit adultery? It's almost like we're enjoying the sin vicariously. You say, no, I'd never kill, I'd never lie, but I like this program where they lie. I'm going to watch this, you know, daytime as my stomach turns, whatever it's called, you know. They got all this intrigue, all this lying, and all this adultery, and this espionage, and this murder, and I'm going, wow, I wonder what's going to happen next. I'd never do that because I'm Christian, but I sure enjoy watching them do it. And it's like we're sinning vicariously. You know, the Bible tells us, let me see, I think I've got that. It may be in the lesson, I just don't remember. Romans chapter 1, verse 32. Who knowing the judgment of God, that they that commit such things are worthy of death, the penalty for sin is death, they not only do the same, but they have pleasure in them that do them. Do we have pleasure in watching other things, watching other people sin, being entertained by the world? That makes you who you are. It shapes your thinking. The Lord wants us to think pure thoughts, but it's hard to think pure thoughts if we're filling our minds with typical American media. I mean, I know there are occasionally good things that are on television. There may even be the occasional movie that has something historic or edifying. It is a very rare exception. Most of these things are rated R. They use God's name in vain. They're full of violence. You've got all of these warnings before it comes on. Drugs, violence, sexual content, profanity, nudity, and you get all this, and you're thinking, okay, Lord, hope you can bless all this. I'm going to watch this now for the next 2 hours, but I'm going to worship you 10 minutes later. It affects you. What type of music will a true Christian enjoy? Oh, this is a difficult one. Well, let's look at what the Bible says. Psalm 40, verse 3, he's put a new song in my heart, praise to our God. And music ought to be music that praises God. You know the story in the Bible where King Saul, he had evil spirits that would trouble him. And David came in. Of course, David was a great musician and a songwriter. Wrote about 70 of the Psalms, 150 Psalms that are in the Bible. And it was so whenever the Spirit from God was upon Saul, that David would take a harp and play with his hand. And then Saul would be refreshed and well, and the distressing spirit, there would be an evil spirit was tormenting Saul, would depart from him. So if good music can drive an evil spirit away, would it make sense the devil's got music that would invite the evil spirits in? Now, everyone, we all agree to this point. I mean, how many of you will raise your hands now and say, we agree that there's some music that is inappropriate for Christians? We all agree. How many of you agree that your music is good? See, everyone says, yeah, God hates bad music, but I like only the good stuff. Everyone draws the line, though, in a little different place. There are Bible principles that need to guide us in these things. You want me to tell you what the principles are, huh? The music needs to be glorifying God, and always ask yourself, are the words in the music something that Jesus would be involved in? You're using this gift. Are you praising the Lord? Not every song has to be a Christian song. There's some folk songs, and there's some maybe a patriotic song or something. And there's even a place for march music. There's a place for a romantic song with you and your wife. I wrote a song for Karen before we got married. I'm not going to sing it for you. But, number 11, is dancing good recreation for a Christian? Well, it depends. Are there people in the Bible that danced? David danced before the ark. Miriam danced. But the typical dancing of the world is often sexually suggestive. He who says he abides in him ought himself to walk even as he walked. And, you know, you go to the temple, typical place where people are dancing, and they're doing, I have no rhythm, so I won't even pretend. But, and they're doing all the shimmy and shake, and they're doing it with a girl, and they're usually gyrating the parts of the anatomy that are calculated to arouse the opposite sex. It's like a mating ritual with very syncopated music, right? And you go, I just can't picture Jesus out there, you know, doing the Saturday Night Live. That's probably not the dancing. In the Bible, the women danced with the women. They were songs of victory and rejoicing. You can read that with the daughter of Jephthah, with Miriam, and the other times when David came back. The women were dancing with the women. They were songs of praise. David danced before the Lord, go to a Jewish wedding. Karen and I were in Jerusalem for the Sabbath, and the men all danced together. Matter of fact, the men are on one side and the women on the other. You don't even let the two come together. And they're dancing and praising the Lord when the Sabbath begins together. But typical worldly dancing, you just have to say, what would Jesus do? Teaching us denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. Can you say amen? Very quickly now, will a Christian play the lottery or gamble? We touched on this earlier. No, the Bible says the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from their faith, and in their greediness it's pierced themselves through with many sorrows. I know people that have lost their last dime because they became addicted to gambling. Something that you can become addicted to is usually not good for a Christian. If you're doing it, your brother's going to become addicted. Why would you do something to make your brother stumble? Again, it tells us, we are commanding you that if anyone will not work, neither shall they not eat. And the Bible says, he who hastens to be rich will not go unpunished. Anyone trying to get rich quick, that's usually dangerous. What should be the aim of God's people today? Very simple, friends. We keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight because we love the Lord. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they might enter through the gates of the city and eat from the tree of life. Number 14, what makes it easy to obey God in the matters of lifestyle discussed in this lesson? Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. I told you at the beginning, this is only for those that love the Lord and you've committed your life to him. To find out what pleases God. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And notice, his commandments are not burdensome. When you love somebody, you are happy to serve them. You're happy to make changes to please them because you love them. I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart. This is all about a heart change. And when God changes your heart, friends, you're going to notice there's a change in your refrigerator. When he changes your heart, there will be a change in your closet. When God changes your heart, there'll be a change in your wallet. Everything begins to change when he changes your heart. Why is the Christian life such a high calling? But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, that you might proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Friends, God is calling you out of that darkness. Do you want to listen to that call and say, Lord, help me. Help me to start living and make practical changes so that I could be a light in the world. Jesus said, you are the light of the world. Do you want to live and love a life that will please and honor God? In this last generation, God is calling people everywhere back to biblical Christianity. The Bible is calling us to be pure in heart and pure in life. And that means we may need to live different. Now, he wants us to love everybody and do all we can to reach everybody. But first, we need to surrender our lives to him and be willing to let him shine and live his life out within us. Do you want to do that, friends? Let me pray with you. Loving Lord, please send the Holy Spirit to each person that's heard this message. Help us know how to apply it to our lives that we might shine for you. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.